G'day, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Brass on Tap. Thanks so much for your support and everything that is going on. I hope a lot of you have tuned in again as from last week when we had Ella Vizzuti on. What an absolute gent and what a killer trumpet player, spreading his wisdom, his books, his writing, his trumpet playing with the world. It was a great session with him, and I hope to do it again in the future. We've got some incredible people coming up on further down, but I can't let you know what dates or who they are yet because they haven't all quite confirmed yet, but they definitely want to be on, so we just need to get that sorted. However, my guest tonight, Craig Wild, what an absolute legend. So much of his work is done behind the scenes. You'd probably know him from Strictly Come Dancing. Well, if you've been to the movies, you've probably definitely heard him. However, before we do all that, before we get him on, make sure at the end of this, you head over to YouTube and check out the Brass on Tap and check out some previous episodes. Also, you can head over to Craig Wild's website and check out what's going on with him. But for now, let's get the stream started. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, Craig Wild is here with us. Who would have thought that in a normal year, this gentleman would have been too busy working shows, recording sessions, or anything like that for us to grab him, especially this time of night. So let's get him on. Craig, how you doing, buddy?
Hello.
Happy to see you.
How are you?
Thanks so much for coming and joining
me tonight.
Yeah, no, more than welcome.
Absolutely.
So, you've got a very exciting gig coming up this weekend, which we're going to talk about later. I would like to just quickly start, just a little bit about, people might want to know how your years are going, your year has gone. Obviously, crazy times, still in lockdown, what the hell. But I think a lot of people just want to know how you've been, you know, going with this, and you know, I've had a lot of messages come through saying it puts them at ease that people are in the same place as guys who are really doing it and stuff like that. So if you could just tell us what's been going on last year for you.
Just before the lockdown, I was out in Germany doing a Rat Pack tour, and while we were out there, it was very clear that the tour was not going to finish. Mm-hmm. And they ended up, Germany locked everything down way before we did over here. So we did a few gigs out there with those Rat Pack guys, and they sent us home. There was no flight, so we had to come home on a tour bus all the way from the other side of Germany, from East Germany. So, but we made the most of that. Anyway, we got back and everything was locked down.
That's it, yeah. Wow.
That was it. That was end of February, beginning of March for me. And funnily enough, I just decided to put the trumpet away. So I put it away for 2.5 months.
Right.
Which is the first time I've ever done in, it's coming up to 40 years I've been playing now. So
now on a general year, you wouldn't have had the opportunity to ever do that, would you?
No, not at all. Yeah. Well, I don't ever remember, apart from the odd holiday, not even having a week off or anything, you know, over the last however long. So I put it away, and then after a while you get the urge again to pick it up. I enjoyed not touching it for a while, to be honest.
Yeah.
But then you get the urge again and gradually build the chops up. And I could see there were a few studios starting to open. Mm-hmm. So obviously if you do get a call, you have to be ready. So which is why I got the horn out and started building things up again. And then after the first lockdown, there were quite a few film sessions going that I was very lucky to do, about five or six, I can't remember, things of that. But that was once every month or something, or twice a month. So you've got to keep your chops going and
of course
keep the willpower up to practice, which was not easy.
Yeah.
And then I was very lucky that we did the Strictly sessions, for the series. We did the Strictly series, which kept, well, that was once a week, so that kept me going till end of December. And then since then, I haven't done a gig or anything. So
that's crazy. So literally, it must be insane. Obviously, we've gone through with previous people, you know, like this time will never probably happen again. I think the world would become a lot more prepared for anything like this to happen again. I'd like to think so anyway. And let's touch wood that nothing ever does happen again like this. So you just touched, like, that's insane that you put it away for 2.5 months. And but I love that you said that, because there are some people that, you know, they always think, oh, I can't take time off. I got to keep going. And now here's a question for you. Did taking those 2.5 months off sort of just allow you to be you and then actually find the passion back into playing trumpet again?
Well, I didn't do it for any finding myself reason or anything like that. But it was just, you know, for the last more than 20 years, 25 years or something, I've been very lucky to be busy.
Yeah.
And practice is there when you've got a couple of days off, but if you've got one day off, you're that busy playing lots of different things all the time. It wasn't a massive schedule I stuck to unless I had a few days off. So just literally not having to get it out and keep the strength and everything working was a nice break. But it was always, I was always looking forward to times when I could get back to playing. And I like to think we've learned a few things that meant I wasn't worried about taking much time off. Because I knew that if I gave myself the right amount of time to get back into things and get back into playing the right way, by, you know, gently building up the practice and not expecting too much straight away. And I knew within a couple of weeks I'd be okay, you know.
Yeah.
Because it's a muscular thing, and you just got to rebuild the muscles. You don't have to retrain muscles when you've been playing for 40 years. You just have to rebuild the strength, and the mental side of it tells you whether it's right or wrong, you know. So I wasn't too bothered about having the time off, whether it was going to be detrimental, as long as I knew I had time to build the strength back up and the, you know, the articulation and things that do disappear after a bit of time off. So, but, you know, I made sure I had time to do that.
Yeah, I mean, it's, you got to, you're at this stage in your life now where you know where you need to be, if you know what I mean, to make that work, to be able to go in. So for our younger viewers out there, could you just touch on... how they would go about being able to find that, how they would go about building their strength or their articulation, stuff that you may work on to get yourself back?
Well, to get myself back to roughly, there's no better practice than going out and playing a gig or doing something that, you know, but the practice you can do at home, I was very aware that I needed to gently get back into things. So I just literally sat, put a film on, sat on the couch with the trumpet and just played quiet, long notes for a couple of, you know, probably about an hour until the chops started to feel as though whatever I was doing was going to stop. Because, you know, after that much time off, the lips thin out and things stop vibrating. So
yeah, of course.
I just played long, slow notes for a few days until it felt rubbish, then put it down and then come back a bit later and but never tried to, I didn't play out of the stave for about 3 or 4 days.
Yeah.
Just because I knew that I had to get back. And I didn't want to do any damage or get into any bad habits that you might get into by not having the strength that you're used to and the placement of the mouthpiece and the tongue and stuff. And then after that, I went back to my brass band roots and I got some old cornet solos, some cornet air variations out, and I just basically played the cornet for a week.
Wow.
It's a bigger bore, bigger mouthpiece, so it's a little bit more forgiving when you've not played for a while. I mean, when I say forgiving, I mean it's terribly hard to make it sound right, but I just felt that I knew that going back to the brass band roots would help with the tonguing, the articulation, the airflow, and all those things, and get those things back working. And I wanted to make sure all that was back somewhat in place before I then started to play any lead trumpet charts or anything like that.
Of course.
And, you know.
Yeah, so you just mentioned it, the brass band. That was your childhood, really, wasn't it?
And it was indeed. Yeah.
Yeah, and the UK has some of the best brass bands in the world, if not the best brass bands in the world. It's incredible. Now, did you come from a musical family?
No. No, okay. Both my parents were non-musical, but the opportunity that we were given when we were very young, me and my brother, we were very lucky with. My mum taught at a school called Wardle High School in Rochdale. And in that school, the old headmaster, Mr. Anderson, had set up a thing where every child at 11, so year 7, when they went into the school, had the opportunity to play a brass instrument.
Right.
And then there were lots of brass banders that were teachers there as well, so they would all teach after school. And then you would stay with your own year group band as you moved up the years. So everybody kind of got better together. But every year group had a brass band. There was also a wind band there at the time as well. But because my mum was teaching there, she thought me and my brother might want to learn. So when I was 6, my brother would be 8, I started on cornet. And my brother started drum and percussion lessons.
Amazing.
So I remember the first lesson I had was with one of the girls who was in the school, in one of the bands. She was one of the principal cornetists. And I remember going for lessons with her, being frightened to death. And then after a little while, I ended up having private lessons off a fantastic trumpet player who used to go in and out of the Liverpool Phil and all that. But he taught lots of players, a guy called Roy Ramsbottom. And he taught some other great players that came out through that school, like Lee Rigg, and who went on to be with Black Dyke for a lot of years. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Lee's now back teaching at the school.
Is he? Oh, wow. So, turnaround.
Yeah, yeah. Well, he has been for a long time, actually. Yeah. Lee runs a couple of bands there, and they've had a lot of success as well with European competitions as well as national and stuff.
That's great.
So it all came through. My mum was a French teacher, so she wasn't musical, but my mum and dad gave me the opportunity to start early on, really, 6 years old, yeah.
Wow. I mean, it's an amazing opportunity. I mean, I personally started very similar. I think it was about 8. I was 8 years old, and I ended up playing in brass bands till I started traveling. So for about 15 years. So I'd like to hear your opinion. For me, being able to learn how to play 100 notes in 4 bars, it became in handy. It almost forced you to become better all the time and push you faster. So I'd recommend it. How about yourself?
Absolutely. Absolutely. The trumpet teacher I had, Roy, obviously we would learn the brass band things, but even when I went to high school at 11 years old, you know, by that point we'd started doing like the air variations and things.
Yeah.
And doing the grades, but Roy would have me playing some classical trumpet concerto pieces. You know, at that age, you don't get through it. Well, yeah. I didn't get through it as well as I would have hoped, but at that age, you don't know the difference. So, you know, you practice them. But he also would mix the lessons up, and he'd get some Glenn Miller tunes out for me to play and things like that. But the teaching I had from him was all a classical approach to playing the trumpet, with a lot of airflow, tonguing, evenness of notes, and triple tonguing, double tonguing, but the evenness of it and the musicality of it as well. So as I went through school, I had a head start on the rest of the guys in my year, but I was very lucky for them to allow me to do solo features and stuff of air variations and things like that, you know. And it was a perfect beginning
course, yeah.
That I still go back to. I still remember some of the things I was taught about placement of notes and what to do. I've still got the handwritten notes from when I was a kid on the air variation parts, and I still practice them, and I can see my writing from being a kid. And, but, you know, the things I wrote on there, I was told to write on there, and they still make absolute sense today.
Exactly. I don't know who I think I've told some of the people that I work with, but I said sometimes, it depends what kind of solo it is, but sometimes I'll always just write in massive letters like I used to when I was a kid. Breathe. Because sometimes you just forget, you know, and it's just, it's amazing just having that C there across the top. It's like, oh, okay, yeah, I should probably breathe. But yeah.
Absolutely, yeah. Yeah. I've got that written all over the place. Exactly. I still write it all over the place.
Exactly. So, So, Do you reckon that doing that kind of brass band upbringing and pushing you to do solos and stuff like that, did you ever suffer from nerves, or was that something that helped you get over that?
I remember being nervous lots. I used to do some solo contests around the area and stuff, Rochdale Music Festival. I remember doing that very young and being absolutely frightened to death before going on. And the nerves of all of that. Yeah, absolutely. And then, you know, you'll do a brass band concert at the school or something. You play all the charts, and then you've got an air vary to do. And I remember being very nervous about it, yeah.
Yeah.
And, you know, I think everybody would be at that age. And see, the thing with nerves I've found is that it never disappears.
Yeah.
You just, with age and experience, you learn to control it differently. Yeah. That's all, you know.
That's a great way of putting it. And I think a lot of people get nervous is because, for one, they want the appreciation of what they're doing to be heard. But I think it's also a lot of people get passionate about what they're doing, and they want it to be the best, you know. So, you know, just I think Alan Vizzuti was perfect last week because he went, well, I'm not perfect. I don't play every night. I mean, it sounds like he does, but he says he doesn't play every note perfect. But he goes, but I still go out there and enjoy it, and you know, and that's what it is. So in the end, he's not looking for the perfect performance. He's looking for the perfect concert, like storytelling. You know, it's not perfect as in note wise. It's perfect as in what he's trying to get across. And I think that's something we all need to think of.
I think everybody, whether it's a full concert or just one piece or something, I think the people that I don't want to say are most successful, but people have a mentality of they want to perform as well as they can for themselves.
Yes.
And the audience, it's not a secondary thought, but you're in your own brain when you're up there doing it, you're playing to play your the best ability that you can.
Yeah.
And hopefully that the audience will like it.
You know? Yeah, exactly.
And I know Alan, I've met him quite a few times, and he is ridiculous. Absolutely phenomenal trumpet player, you know, and but he practices, and he has this mentality of when he's working and on stage that's what it's all about, and the concentration levels are huge with him, you know.
Yeah.
And his ability from over the years of practicing and his experience allow him to be as good as he is, you know.
Yeah, I've heard multiple times from people, always they say, fill your bag with stuff that you can do, and then you can draw upon it when you're doing your solo, you know, and that's what we do, and that's what practice is. You just
absolutely
put it in that bag. But yeah, Jane Conway's come across, and she says, Roy Ramsbottom now lives in the Canary Islands. So
hey, Jane. Yeah, Jane was at school with me.
Was she?
Jane's a very fine tenor horn player as well, yeah.
Oh, lovely.
Yes, I got in touch with Roy. I hadn't seen him since I was about 18. And then about 5 or 6 years ago, I managed to get an email for him and sent him an email. And because he moved to the Canary Islands.
Wow.
20-something years ago. And we were back in touch. I sent emails back and forth, and
how small the world is now, eh?
I know.
It's crazy.
But, yeah.
So that's great. Yeah. Guys, just remember, if you've got questions for Craig, please get them in, because obviously, you know, I don't want to keep him all night. So if you've got them, don't be shy. Ask some questions.
It's okay. I've got a glass of wine.
There we go. So we walked through the brass band. So when did your love, inspiration maybe? Or what? When did your love for jazz, commercial, big band, apart from obviously Roy introducing you to Glenn Miller, when was there a point where you're like, you know what, I want to do shows, I want to do West End stuff, I want to eventually have my own big band, which is what you do. Do you know what I mean? Like, when did that passion come along?
Well, the shows and running my own thing came a lot later.
Right.
But I went to Salford University at 16, straight from school, to do my A-levels. I then stayed there to do a degree. But when I remember I auditioned at 16 years old with Del Steiger's Carnival of Venice for Dave King, wonderful cornet player.
Yeah.
Dave was head of the course, yeah. And Dave was like, great. That went well. Yeah, we'll have you. Who do you want to teach you? And I went, I want the jazz big band trumpet teacher. And he was like, what? And I remember it vividly. Yeah. And I just wanted to go down that route.
Cool.
I still carried on playing in the college brass band whilst I was there.
Yeah.
But I joined the college big band, and my teacher there at college was Dave Browning. Dave used to play with the Northern Dance Orchestra for years, did all sorts of things. Syd Lawrence, I think he played with Maynard a few times as well. But Dave was one of the main players on, there's been several over the years, but Dave was one of the main players who recorded the Coronation Street theme and stuff.
Wow, yeah.
So I had lessons off Dave. But I remember the big switch came when I auditioned for the college big band. And Mike Thomas, great trumpet player. Mike was playing lead trumpet.
Yeah, right.
Neil Yates was in the band. And I was just this 16-year-old. And Mike Gorman, great jazz pianist who plays with everybody now, Mike accompanied me on it. And I played a transcribed Charlie Parker solo. Because I was a brass bander. I could get around all the notes, yeah. But I wasn't an improviser of any sort. But I'd learned a Charlie Parker solo of Lover Man, a transcription. Mm-hmm. So I auditioned with that and then got in on fourth trumpet. And then all of a sudden, I'm hearing all these great charts and high notes. And I remember Mike Thomas gave me my first shallow mouthpiece. But I'd been on the same one since I was eight. Yeah, it's Mike's fault. Absolutely. Mike's got a lot to answer for because he gave me my very first West End dep as well.
Did he?
So I've got a lot to be thankful to Mike for.
Definitely.
And and once we were in there, I was sat on fourth trumpet in as you do, you know.
Yeah, of course.
And listening to Mike and Nigel Beer and Tracy and all these others that were in the band, and I've kept in touch with a lot of them as well since then, which is lovely. I remember Mike gave me a mixtape of trumpet artists. There was Maynard, there was Roger Ingham, Paul Casey. It was all the silly feature stuff,
yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
And I was just like, wow, this is brilliant. And then me and Mike went to watch Harry Connick live in Liverpool. It was, and just blown away, you know. And then the other major thing that Mike Thomas, I have to thank him for, is while I was at college in the big band with him, he was doing a big band. Andy Pryor is a fantastic singer. He had this great big band with Malcolm Merling, Georgina Bromelow was in it. Frosty was in it, oh, Mark Frost.
Yeah.
And Mike was in it. But Mike then went on a cruise. He got offered a cruise ship. So he asked me to then join Andy Pryor's band.
Oh, wow.
Oh, he asked me to go on audition for Malcolm Mellon.
Yeah.
So I went to Blackpool Tower, and I remember we went backstage, and Malcolm, he gave me In the Mood. Play that as loud as you can. And he gave me Moonlight Serenade and said, play that as quiet as you can. I said, right, I'll see you at the Winter Gardens next week for a gig. And I'm like, okay. So I'm, you know, very early into playing that style of music,
yeah,
you know, let alone even having any high chops or anything. And then I remember we did this gig, and my sight reading was always pretty good,
yeah. brass bands.
I could play all the notes on fourth trumpet, and it was fine. But at the end of it, Mal, he said, "Yeah, well done." He said, "Do me a favor though, go and buy a Glenn Miller album and just listen to it, and listen to it, and listen to it." And so I did. And then by listening and listening, you get it in your head, the right style to play, and this and that and the other. And then I stayed with Andy's band for about 12 years.
Holy smokes.
Fantastic. So all those three major things very early on, you know, auditioning for the college big band, joining Andy Pryor's band, and then my first ever West End debut, all came from Mike Thomas. So thank you, Mike.
Well done, Mike Thomas. Thank you. I mean, that's incredible. And I think you just nailed something on the head, which a lot of people are, which we can't do enough, I think, is just listen to all the styles, listen to all the greats doing it, you know, and in the end, you don't have to emulate them, you know, like try and sound like them. You've got to sound like yourself, but to get that style, you know, it has to be, you know, you got to listen. You can't get it any other
way.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So style is the main thing. I've been very lucky to play lots of different types of music all through my career so far. And if I'm going doing an orchestral thing, I'll listen to orchestral music, and then if I've got even just big band music, there's so many different styles of music in big band. If I'm going doing a Basie gig, I'll stick Basie Live at the Sands on and just immerse myself into that. And if I'm doing a Sinatra thing, I'll stick Frank on and just listen to Conrad Gozzo. And you know, but just within big band, there's so many different styles of way of playing. And then, you know, then you've got all the Earth, Wind & Fire stuff, the Tower of Power things, which is a whole different way of playing. The Motown things.
Yeah.
You know, there's so many. Music's just isn't just music. There's so many different facets to it. It's huge. And you know, listening and preparing, you can prepare yourself just by listening, really. Without, you don't have to bash the chops all the time, but the mental side of it, of knowing what's expected and how to blend and do things like that, it all comes from just listening, you know.
Yeah, exactly. And I mean the countless, I'm sure you're the same, but the countless sort of soul band gigs or stuff like that, or function band gigs, and you rock up, and I mean the pad's completely different, but you know the songs in your head. And you're just like, here it is. Yeah, okay, cool. You know, and then it's off, and you know the style and everything. And it's only up here because of the amount of times you've gone through it, you know, and everything like that. So it's a great way to get ahead of it for all our young viewers out there. So please go and listen. And funny enough, you probably heard this man do quite a lot of stuff as well. So moving on a bit. So you went into West End shows. When did you progress and sort of start getting the calls up with the sessions? Do you have some cool stories? Like Mike Lovett had a great story about, you know, when he went onto the James Bond one and stuff like that. Do you have some cool stories that you have?
Yeah, well, it took quite a few years to do things, you know.
When did the high jump
like sessions and stuff? Well, I was at college.
Okay.
You know, I ended up playing first trumpet with the band, and chops weren't already there. But while I was at college, I joined the Wigan Youth Jazz Orchestra.
Yep.
Which was a huge part of. I was already out doing soul bands and things. There's a fantastic soul band I played with for years, Frisco Crab and the Atlantic Frantics.
And what a name!
Yeah, it was brilliant. I loved it. Loved it. And some great players in that band as well. Yeah. Neil Fairclough's gone on to be the bass player with Queen.
Yeah.
Andy Treacy was drumming. He's went on to be the drummer with Faithless and all this lot. And John, who ran it, the singer, he, you know, we still keep in touch. So we did all that, which was brilliant. But I joined the Wigan Youth Jazz Orchestra. And while I was there, Andy Green was playing lead trumpet in the band.
Monster. Love it.
We got these opportunities to... just with the jazz festivals that they had and the concerts, Ian Darrington, who ran it, would get the most amazing world-class players over. Big band, Woody Herman, Basie, Maynard, all this lot.
Still do.
So we got to hang out. Yeah, we got to hang out with those. But the main major thing that helped with my chops was Bobby Shue used to come over once a year.
Yeah.
And he would live at Ernie Garside's house in Manchester. Ernie used to be Maynard's manager, and he played in Maynard's band. So whilst Bobby was over, we'd do gigs with him with the Wigan band, but we'd go, he was over for a month at a time or something. We'd go and have a lesson once a week and then do gigs with him in between. And Bobby was the main person that helped me get my chops better.
Yeah,
all round, and I still speak to Bobby on a regular basis, and I spoke to him this week actually.
Did you?
Well, he's been very influential in this concert we've got going on amazing. Sunday, but we can come to that later. Yeah. But so, yeah, Bobby and the Wedge Breath and the all that lot helped with that, got me together with the higher chops that I'd never even thought of getting before, you know.
Yeah, I mean, Bobby is a very well known for the yoga breath. And being able to teach it and being one of the best at doing that. It's Bobby Shu is one of the funniest stories. You could probably confirm this story. One of the funniest stories I've heard about this was when I think he got like a brand new set of mutes or something, and he was tapping the Harman mute on his chair while teaching a lesson. And he's just like, sounds better with some dents in it. But he's just an all-round cool cat. And the amount of people that I've met through the brass world, and this is all around the world as well, and just they've always said Bobby Shu changed my playing, always for the better.
There's not many of the guys I come across who don't regard Bobby as the premier trumpet teacher.
Yeah,
for commercial and jazz and all of that. Course. You know, he's the premier teacher in the world. You know, he taught all the guys we listen to from the States and everything, with Wayne Bergeron, Roger Ingram, you know, all those guys, Eric Miyashiro. There's a huge list. They all went to Bobby for lessons in LA, you know, and Bobby has a specific approach to playing the trumpet. And he studied the biology of the body and all this. So he knows exactly what's happening when the diaphragm moves and this and that and the other, and the throat opens and all the muscles in the face. And he learned that, you know, he was already a busy musician anyway, and playing Bobby with Elvis, Buddy Rich, all this stuff, Louis Belson. But Bobby has learned over the years all the massive in-depth process of what the body goes through when you're playing, you know. So he can just hear straight away whether things are too tight here or there, or you're not breathing properly and all this stuff. So he's taught so many people over the years, and you know, everybody just looks up to him as the boss, you know.
The boss, yes. Well, I am gonna try and I am gonna try and get the boss on this channel if I can. I just need to get the right email to the right person and make sure that he gets it.
I'll give him a call if he'll be fine.
Great. I'll send him your interview and he'll be like, yeah, wicked. Okay. So John Henley's come on. And he says, do you ever consider teaching or doing masterclasses? Cheers for tuning in, Johnny. Gonna come to that. Do you teach yourself?
I do. I've never taught in schools or anything.
Right.
But over the years, I've done one-to-one teaching. It's just whoever. I don't put myself out there to do it. But in fact, there's a guy I'm teaching at the moment, Rick Starr, who's an ex-policeman. He's got back into playing. He got in touch with Bobby. And Bobby taught him online for a couple of times and then suggested, instead of doing that, give Craig a ring. So I've started teaching Rob, you know. It's a once a month thing or something.
It's great.
But over the years, I've done several masterclasses, and I love doing masterclasses and running rehearsals of things. Years ago, I used to run a few Nigel rehearsals. In fact, I've got a masterclass I'm teaching on Tuesday coming at University of Salford.
Oh, great.
They've asked me to go and do that. I've been up and did some brass workshops and masterclasses with the Royal Northern College of Music a few years ago, and I really enjoy doing that. I've done a few with some youth bands down in Aylesbury and things, and I'm quite happy to teach, but it's just not something I've ever put myself out there to do. But if anyone's interested, absolutely.
So how would they get in contact with you, via your website?
Absolutely, send me an email, mail@craigwild.com, and
there you go.
Just give us a call, yeah.
give him a call, guys. Get him in because he's great. So we're not going to hamper on about the yoga breath. But you said you said that because I mean that's another stream all on its own, isn't it? From what I heard, anyway.
it can get quite in depth. It's a process where you break it down into several steps, and then you have to build yourself up and da da da, and eventually turn it into one step that becomes something fluid. But yes, you're right. To break that down would take a while, but you know.
But if anyone does want to learn it, are you more than happy for people to call you?
Absolutely, yeah. Brilliant. I really enjoy doing that. Yeah.
I might give you a call because I've always been intrigued.
you don't need it, man.
Anyway, I just wanted to break down a little bit because you said Bobby Shue, you know, he analyzed you, but you know, he saw things that are happening, helped you open them up, he helped him work. So was there any exercise book or is there anything that sort of helped you get to that stage? You know, for our guys out there that are sort of, because we do promote on here a bit of self-discovery, a bit of, you know, like Louis said a lot of that, where you need to find it within yourself. Too many people ask, like people like yourself or Louis or Andy or Simon Gardner, you know, and they're just like, oh, how do you play high? And it's like, it's not as simple as that. You can't just go here, push a button, play high. So is there something that sort of helped you get to that stage to have such a successful and accurate top range?
Lots of practice, but it's the right type of practice. And like you said, everybody's different. So, you have to tailor it for yourself. And it's a lot of it is practicing and being aware of what's happening when you're playing, inside the mouthpiece with the aperture, and the breath control. The easiest thing to teach somebody is if you want to play high, you've got to breathe properly. That's the number one thing. You know, we can go into all the aperture control and the throat and this and that and the other and all the exercises that physically build the muscles. But it's never going to work unless you breathe properly, you know. I vary my practice even today. Still, I do some days classical, some days I'll just do some lifting weights, trying to get higher and building that up, you know. You know, Bobby has books out that I studied, but I've also been through the Maggio, the Caruso, I've never been one to just concentrate on one particular thing. Yes, you do when you're practicing that, but the next day I might try a different method.
Of course.
You know, you know, per day you have to stick with what you're going to set yourself out to practice, because if you're going to mess your face up if you spend half an hour classical and half an hour trying to smack lead high notes out, I think you need to do it per day, you know, find a classical day, a high day, a jazz day or whatever, and do it like that, you know. So I always go back to the Arban as well, because I grew up with the Arban,
of course,
you know. And then there's loads of stuff online nowadays as well, which is amazing that you can find it. There's loads of stuff out there from great trumpet players from the 50s and 60s that you can just download and just go through it, give it a go, and
massively,
as long as you know you're not going to do anything wrong by trying something new.
Correct.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, definitely.
Hey Ben.
Yeah.
My earphones are just dying, even though I charged them up fully before I started.
Okay.
So if I take them out, can we just give me a second to make sure you can hear?
We can certainly do that. You sort yourself out, bud.
Yeah. I charged them up as well.
So, guys, I think Craig's literally hit the nail on the head. Don't stick to one thing just because someone's told you this is the bee's knees. Obviously, try it. Obviously, take it. But just, you know, try it. And then take bits from it, maybe, you know, like I probably at one point I'm playing with three different techniques from three different books, but I'm putting them all in one, or it works for me because of my shape and my chops and my teeth and everything like that. If you've got this teacher at high school or whatever, and they just said, no, you have to do it this way, or you must play a 1¼ C mouthpiece, just try out stuff for yourself and don't be afraid of change, because I know we're all scared.
I've put together my own practice regime years ago, and the beginning part of it's just is built in as a warm up, you know, and yeah. then we you know, we do the fluttering with which is the shoe just getting the blood flowing and all this lot, and then there's just a bit of maggio, just open C arpeggios, and then you do the caruso, which is gradually increasing the volume back down mm-hmm. to nothing up there, and then I've added other bits from other things that I've really found helpful and put it all together, you know. And then over the years, you realize that you can't really do everything in 1 hour long practice. You've got to practice a particular way one day and then practice a particular way another day. And if you can keep them all the plates juggling, they should help themselves, you know.
Yeah. I mean, so let's work into a little bit of, now we're just sort of talking about a bit of practice, bit of this and that. You get the phone rings, you know, a show comes in, or sorry, not a show, a session recording comes in. Now, sometimes you don't know what you're going to get. Other times I'm guessing you'll know the genre, because I know that you've recorded classical, you know, lead, just session, just, you know, there's a section player. You've done pretty much everything. And you obviously got a Strictly as well, which anything could come up, you know. So, yeah, so how do you think about, I mean, I know you say you listen to the charts and stuff like that, but for a session that you don't know what you're actually doing, or you don't know what kind of style, you know, how do you approach your recording sessions like that and be so accurate, like when you're there? Like, is there a preparation? I think who did I talk to? I think it was Louis said he tries to get there early, he'll play for a bit, and then he'll go get a coffee or something. He'll set himself up and then go.
Absolutely. The golden rule of sessions, in my experience, is get there early. You know, they might not even put the music out until you need it, but I'm always an hour early for every session, because I know if I'm at the studio an hour early, I've got time to go get a cup of tea. Mm-hmm. In the days when all the cafes used to be open at the you can go and get a cup of tea. If it's 10 o'clock start, you know, you might have left at 8 in the morning, go and get a sandwich, because you need food and fluid in your body for your chops to start working properly. Mm-hmm. You know, and then I'll just do a normal I will warm up, but over the years I've got not into the habit of, but I don't need to warm up so much. And yes, if you get there and you can tell what it is, if it's gonna be, you kind of get the idea by who's booked you as to whether it's going to be a big band session or a film session or something like that. But you know, you might turn up and you're playing fourth trumpet in an orchestra of 100 people, or first trumpet in an orchestra of 100 people, or there's quite a few times I've turned up and it's literally a small group and I'm the only trumpet player. And you're like, okay, right, we'll just have to see what we're going to have to play, you know.
Yeah.
And so once you're there, but yeah, literally most of the 90% of the sessions you turn up to, you don't know what you're going to be playing. You don't know whether it's going to be for a pop album or a film or a TV show. You know, most if it's a jingle, which is the adverts stuff, you kind of get an idea about whether it's going to be for that, but you still don't know what type of music it is.
Of course.
So, you know, you've got to make sure that your chops are in the right place all the time to play pretty much play whatever's asked of you.
Yep.
Now, I'm not professing to be the greatest classical player at all. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I'm very lucky that if I am in a classical section, I'm usually there because they need something a little bit higher to be played. And then I'll just sit and just absorb the most phenomenal classical trumpet playing from all the guys, from Phil Cobb to Alan Thomas.
Yeah.
You know, all the regular guys that you work with, whether it's the RPO or whoever. It's kind of like you just have to turn up with the mentality of right, well, we'll find out when we find out. There's no point worrying about anything until you get there.
No, exactly. So if it's all right with you, I'm going to play a clip from Abbey Road Recording Studios with an incredible section. Simon Gardner, yourself, Andy Greenwood, and Pablo Mandelson. It's a ripper. You've only got two. it's two different, like the same line done in two different ways. And you've got a break in the middle. And you just, you actually do what you just preached with his drinks and water in between it as well as everything like that. And it's incredible to watch because the accuracy of this section, and you wouldn't even know this is on the thing. So let's have a listen and we'll have a chat about it afterwards.
Yeah, sure.
It just is one of those things where you just listen to that and you're just like, there it is, like that. That is the level you need to be right there. You know, it's great. It really is. And it's one of those things where a lot of people probably don't know, but obviously through the Cairns, you know, for our young guys out there who haven't done any sessions, through the Cairns, you've got the full band going on. But every other that you can hear in the video, everything else is a pin drop. No noise.
Yeah.
Yeah, and it's just like, and for you guys to come straight back in, same line, no deviation, and it's both, I'm guessing it's both you and Simon up there as well. So
yeah, Simon was on lead trumpet, and I was on second, yeah.
Yeah, so that's a great thing to chat. Sorry to interrupt you, mate. It's a great thing to chat about real quick. So when you've got someone else that, you know, like as we've been talking about, everyone is different completely. So, and everyone probably approaches the high range differently, but you and Simon sound like one player. Is that just taken years or is that something that you've trained yourself to do somehow?
Yeah, it does take a lot of time. I mean, these are all little nuances that you've learned over the years. You know, you're always listening when you're playing. So in that one, I'm always listening to Simon next to me. Got to perfectly match his tuning. If it's long notes, you've got to come off at the same time. If it's a vibrato, you've got to match the vibrato as best you can. Diminuendos, crescendos, you've got to do it all at the same time. And in the commercial world, the lead trumpet player runs all that. You know, yes, it's on the paper, but if the lead player wants to do things slightly different, not just the trumpets, we've got to match in the trombones and the saxes, everything, you know.
Yeah.
And with Simon, he's got so much experience. He knows what's needed from the composers and the styles that's needed, you know. So you're always listening. But when you're playing that high and that loud, your ears do close up with the pressure. You can see the pressure on that. You can see the Bobby Shue breath technique as well. Well, I'm doing that, you know. That's all part of the wedge breath. And you can see the compression that's needed for it. And that compression blocks your ears slightly when you're playing, so you have to have confidence that you can play in tune.
Yeah.
Anyway, but you are doing your best to listen to the lead player all the time.
Of course.
And to match that, and as you, I think I can hear in that all four of us were doing the same thing. So it sounds so big because everybody's, even though the third and Andy and Pablo were down the octave on that one. The tuning's banging in the middle, so it adds this massive wall of sound. If things aren't banging tune or exactly together, you get the waviness of the tuning, and you get this and that and the other. But when everybody's the same, it just comes out as this huge wall.
Yeah.
You know, and it's great fun when you do it.
Yeah.
When it all comes together just like that, it's great fun. You know.
Gets the hair on the back of your neck standing up, doesn't it?
And also in the background of there was Pete Beechill on trombone, and it was Pete's 60th birthday 2 days ago. So happy birthday, Pete.
Oh, happy birthday, Pete. Amazing. Yeah, I mean that's a hell of a band. It really is, and it must be amazing to go to work, like it used to be when Derek was alive. And you see someone like you work day in day out with these incredible trumpet players, and someone like Simon is as experienced as Simon as well, who used to be sort of Derek Watkins' sideman. You know, they were always together on shows,
absolutely,
movies.
Yeah.
So it must be amazing to be in there and learn, you know, and be playing with someone like that. So,
you know, as a slight deviation, I mean, we could talk about Derek more later, but the whole mindset of going to work and doing sessions is something, yes, you learn it by experience, but, you know, there's a lot of young guys like Louis and Tom Walsh, yeah, and all these people that they're still quite young people, but
they get it.
And, you know, and they turn up and, they're early, they do this, they practice, they make sure the chops are right for it. But I was very lucky to do a lot of sessions and shows and big band gigs with Derek Watkins before he died.
Wow.
And Derek was just phenomenal. You know, his feel, his sound, his time, everything was what you would aspire to be as a trumpet player. But his mentality of work as well was phenomenal. I remember I did the last ever session that Derek did. He was very poorly with cancer, and he didn't we didn't know at the time, but he didn't have much longer left. And I got to, it was, I can't remember what it was for, but it was Ben Foster was the conductor and composer. And there was some Bond-ism line in it.
Mm-hmm.
Where Derek had to play, it was just a double A or something, which for Derek was just bread and butter.
Yeah.
But he was very, very poorly. And I got there my 1 hour early, like I always am. And Derek was already sat there in studio.
Wow.
He's already sat there warming up, and he had two different trumpets, a few different lead pipes, different mouthpieces, a piccolo trumpet. And he was just making sure his chops, because he was very, very poorly.
Yeah.
He was struggling. But he sat there for an hour and a half at least before the red light went on, making sure he found the right combination, the easiest way for him to play those notes. And when we started the session, he didn't miss a thing.
Wow.
And he knew he didn't have long left. But even at that period in his life, his work ethic was outrageous, you know.
I think a lot of people
remember that, and just when you turn up to the studio, you just that's what you've got to do. You've got to, it's got to work when the red light goes on. And if you, some days, you know, your chops feel rubbish, so you've got to get there early and warm up. Other days you get there and you go blah blah blah, blah. That's fine, you know. But he knew he had to do that extra work, and he nailed it. Absolutely nailed it.
That's awe-inspiring, to be honest with you, and I think everyone should take that kind of work ethic away with them. And and there's something to be said also, like you just touched on. You know, we're not the same people. If you sleep wrong, or if you haven't got enough sleep, or whatever, you know, the chops do feel different every day. Yeah, you've got to find out. I mean, in your opinion, you're a Yamaha artist yourself, aren't you?
I am. Yeah, I've been with them a lot of years now, 12 years or something.
Amazing. That's incredible.
Yeah.
Well deserved.
Fantastic, yeah.
Yeah, so, I mean, you've obviously come in a lot of sections that have, you know, I mean, trumpet players, we're a bit of hoarders. We hoard mouthpieces, we hoard trumpets, we hoard, you know, I'm actually can put my hand up and say, I bought an expensive one, so I only have one now. I sold two to get one, and I need to save up now for another one. Do you think that the brand, so say you came in, you had two Barks and two Yamahas, does it change, you know, your the sound, the cohesion? You know, are there brands out there that you think, like, say, our amateur or younger guys should stay away from if they're thinking of upgrading and trying to get into this commercial work? Or, you know, like, is, well, just tell us how you would get that cohesion in a section with multiple horns.
Well, I don't think there's brands out there that people should stay away from.
No, obviously not. But yeah, that's probably, poor words.
But what I mean is, you go to a shop and they will have 10 different makes of trumpets on the wall that you can try. And, you know, they all come out of the factories these days being absolutely fine to play.
Yeah, they are, yeah.
You get what you pay for, so it's a little easier to play the more expensive ones because the metals used are different and all this lot. And but absolutely not. No, I mean, I've had a brilliant relationship with Yamaha over the years. Mm-hmm. But before that, I used to play Smith Watkins for a lot of years.
Yeah.
And when I first started, I was on a Bark Strad, and you can't go wrong with Bark Strads.
No.
The different instruments and different makes tend to be played for different types of music, if you know what I mean. You know, the Bessons and the Barks are more classical things, although, you know, there's quite a few guys that play the commercial Barks in the commercial
world. Yeah, there are now.
They're all fantastic instruments, but what I was very lucky with Yamaha is... They basically asked me what I wanted to play, and I went out up to Milton Keynes, where they are in the UK, and I've been out to Hamburg at the European factory for a lot of times. And because I was on a Smith Watkins at the time, but they wanted me to become an endorsee, they just laid out 25 trumpets, everything they had, and said, okay, we're going to blind test.
Yeah, right.
So I had my Smith Watkins that I was quite happy on my Smith Watkins, but Yamaha come to you and go, would you like to play one of ours? And I'm absolutely, you know. And we worked it down, and I found something that ended up being a little easier blowing. And then I went to a few different trumpets with them. But the opportunity they gave you to try them and figure it out was amazing. And then in the end, I've ended up on the new commercial trumpet that they have out.
Great.
They were amazing. They asked me to go out, so I can't remember what year it would be, but about three or four years ago, to Hamburg and test these brand new parts that they'd just come up with. And it was built by Eddie and all the guys in Hamburg. It was their baby to be a European commercial trumpet. That wasn't one of the artist trumpets like Bobby or Wayne.
Yeah.
The other. And their brief was they wanted it to be something that would fit between the artist trumpets and the Zeno range.
Oh, okay. And the Zeno
tend to be more classically played and this and that and the other. So, and they asked me to come out and just put a trumpet together out of all these new parts. And there's me and about five or six other guys from Germany and a couple of guys, Frank Brodahl and things from Norway. And they took everything down that we all said and put it all into graphs and figured out the mean average of everything and put together this commercial trumpet from what us, quite a small group of players.
Yeah.
Thought of it all, and some people chose the different lead pipe or the bell sides or the flare or the valve caps, or there's all these. It's absolutely minute detail that they go into with it. Or even the screws on the third valve.
Yeah.
Depends what it's made out of, whether it's heat treated or whether there's a little cutout in it, or you know, does it's amazing the detail they go into it, and you try all these things out, and the quite small amount of guys that all went through this process of the trumpet with them, I was very lucky to be part of it. They came up with the commercial trumpet, which I've had since it came out, and it's brilliant now. I've got that, and I've got the prototype. That's
amazing.
What now? So
I'm guessing they're stocked in Prozone or Parkers if people want to go buy them.
Absolutely, yeah, you can get them.
Brilliant
from Prozone or Parkers.
Yeah, that must have been incredible to be. involved in, because not many people get an opportunity like that. And we were chatting with Alan last week, and Alan mentioned that as well. You know, he said about the third valve screw, you know, and he said they even tried drilling a hole through it at one point just to see if that would make a difference.
Yeah, I've got like, several here. And then it's this, you know, the brilliance of Yamaha is that when you go out to the factory, there's Eddie, who's the engineer who makes everything. Mm-hmm. And all the other guys who work in there, they have amazing ears. So you go into a room, and there's like three or four guys stood there, and you are blind testing everything. So they'll just hand you the trumpet, and then they'll just get you to play. And then after over a few hours, you know, they're handing you different ones here and there. And then Eddie will go, just let me take this away. And he disappears into the atelier and comes back and, okay, try that. And then you just tell them how it feels different or whether you prefer it. But all the time they're listening out front to not only, it doesn't just matter how it feels to you, it's how it sounds out front.
So exactly.
They give feedback as well, you know.
Yeah.
And they're like, well, that might sound easier to you, but it's got a slightly smaller sound, or it's a bit tinnier sound, or it's not as full or broad. And of course, when you can't hear that because you're the other trumpet, you know. So the amazing guys to work on that with, because their knowledge of how brass instruments work and their ears to be able to hear all these tiny differences. Mm. It's an honor to be part of doing something like that with them.
Definitely. The podcast Behind the Bell, you said it exactly right. You don't actually get to hear. Most times you don't get to hear, but everyone knows that sound in their head that they want to sound like. And so I've got a couple of questions for you. When you're thinking of playing, we could go through a couple of genres. Obviously, you don't have to pinpoint people, but who are you thinking of when you play certain styles? And could you quickly touch on, for some of our guys, if they're going to go try and looking to buy a new trumpet, obviously maybe take someone with you, so they can listen to you.
Absolutely.
But apart from that, what kind of stuff are you playing when you're picking up different trumpets? Are you playing the same stuff each time, or do you go through certain things? Like, you just go through what you're looking for, like, to help them out?
Well, if you're going to go and buy a new horn, you've got to think about what you're going to use it for.
Mm-hmm.
And you know what type of stuff you're going to play, and then whether it's a larger bore or a smaller bore, what mouthpiece are you going to put in it? Are you going to try and play a lead trumpet with a tiny mouthpiece in it? It might work the way your body is built and your lips are built, that you have a small mouthpiece but this huge large bore horn, or some people prefer it with a slightly larger mouthpiece but a smaller horn. It's such a personal thing. That when you, but basically, you know, you take your mouthpiece, obviously. And you just, there's two things. You need a horn that sounds nice to listen to. You know what I mean? It's not just about getting a darker sound or a really bright sound or anything. People have to listen to it.
Yeah.
And if people who are listening to it think it sounds horrible and tinny or fluffy and dark, and that's not their thing, you know.
Yeah.
But if you're going to play a small jazz thing, and then you might want a darker sound, and you've got to kind of know in your head what you want it to sound like. And then the other major thing is to find something that you find easy blowing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's always the payoff between something that's easy blowing and easy to play high on, because usually the smaller bore gives you more compression to sit back and play high on.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that might end up being a bit too small and tinny. So, but then if you go too big, it's harder to play high on. So you've got to come up with a compromise in the equipment you're using, depending on what you're going to play.
Yeah.
And actually that was the whole thing for the commercial Yamaha trumpet that we worked on and I've got. It was something that would be commercial, so you could play in every situation with, you know. And it works for me that I don't sound like the classical guys, but I try my best to.
Yeah.
When I work with them, and I I've got a couple of mouthpieces that, that Yamaha have made for me that, you know, one of them I put in that's bigger and a bigger throat so I can try and sound and blend into the section with an orchestra. And then I have my smaller one, which works for the commercial things, you know. And but I find that the trumpet allows me to do both. Mm-hmm. And it, it kind of it reacts to the way you play it.
Yeah.
So, yeah, just when you go and finding a trumpet, it's not always about one that you find really easy to play or the one you can play the highest on. That's just,
yeah,
that's rubbish because honeymoon periods happen with trumpets as well. You know, after a couple of weeks,
yeah,
you feel like, oh, it's hard again.
It's probably the most expensive mistake you've ever made.
Oh, yeah. So, you know, mainly it's knowing what you want.
Yeah.
In your own head when you go and what you want to get out of whatever instrument you find. And, you know, most makes these days cover such a wide genre.
Yeah.
You know, Bach have gone into the commercial thing as well, but Yamaha have this huge range of the Chicago, the New York, all these big, great classical trumpets.
Yeah.
The Zeno range, you know, but then they have the artist range, the mm-hmm. you know, the Shoes, the Miyashiro, the Bergeron, which might not necessarily be right for everybody because they're designed for those particular artists.
Of course.
Which is why they tried to fill the gap between the Zeno and the artist with the commercial, you know.
Well, of course, because I mean, the Eric Marsh, to me, the Eric Marsh-era and Wayne Bergeron play completely different. You know, but that's because they're built for those two guys and they are different.
Yeah.
So just be aware that, you know, for our guys out there, if you're looking for an instrument and don't get me wrong, both those trumpets are incredible trumpets, but
they're all great trumpets.
Yeah. But don't think that you got to pick one up and just sound like Wayne Bergeron.
And it's going to sound great.
Yeah.
But you've got to be aware that am I going to have to work too hard on this or do I like to work a bit harder?
Then
they allow me to work, you know.
Some people do. Like, there's days where I would actually prefer a bit more of an open blow. Do you know what I mean? Like, myself. So, you know, and there's things like that. That's a future talk with myself, you know, and I'll go away and have that one.
Well,
so
that comes from what you said earlier in the fact that every day you wake up and your chops feel different.
Exactly. Completely.
You know, some days some days you need a tuba and some days you need a penny whistle.
Yeah, it certainly is. I forgot to say as well, Albert popped along to say hey. Thanks so much for coming in, Albert, or the old man, as I used to call him when I worked on ships. Absolute legend.
Did you work with Albert?
I work with Albert on the Queen Mary too, yeah.
Oh, brilliant.
So I was the 6 o'clock kid and he was the old man. So, he was a fantastic trumpet player. So, thanks so much for popping along, Albert. So just to touch before we wrap things up and chat about what's happening this weekend, just touch on a bit of some of your inspirations for us, if you can, like, you know, who's inspired you to get where you are?
Absolutely, yeah. Well, when I know when I first started out, in fact, I've still got a vinyl album signed by Philip McCann.
Yeah.
From when I first started out as a kid and wanted to play cornet, Phil McCann was just like, I say what I wanted to sound like. And not at that age, you don't really aspire to sound and do this, but mm-hmm. he was somebody who I really took inspiration from. And then, you know, you go through brass band and then you go into the big band world. And Maynard was one of the first that I came across and I was like, oh my God, you know. and then, you know, all the other great lead players, Snooky Young, Conrad Gozzo and all this lot of all, they're still people who aspire to play like in some way. You know what I mean? Whether it's the feel or the time or this and that and the other, you'll never sound like them.
No.
But as far as making a sound at the trumpet and the noise I want to make, I've always tried to sound like Bobby Shue. I've always found his the sound he makes. It's something I just want to listen to all the time. You know?
Yeah.
No matter when he plays low and especially his flugel playing, it's beautiful.
Yeah.
You know,
And so sound wise, I've always looked towards Bobby, but over the years, I've wanted to be Roger Ingham. I wanted to be John Faddis, and then I wanted to be Wayne Bergeron.
I think you're
always inspired by all these guys, but growing up, it was definitely, Maynard and then just Bobby, because I've had so much influence from Bobby. Yeah. But I've had the influence because I've wanted to, because I've always just loved how he played and what he sounded like when he played the trumpet.
I think your humbleness and variety of players that you have that listen to and adore comes out in your playing. And I think that is something that we can all learn from, in a way of listen to everyone, know everyone, and you can drag upon that experience that you've had with that when the time's needed. Do you know what I mean?
Absolutely. I'm a big believer in you're always going to sound like yourself.
Yes. Massively.
As in the noise you make is pretty much going to sound like you. And now the idea is that when you're younger or when you're developing your sound at college or anything like that, that you can lean in a certain direction. Mm-hmm. But you're always going to sound like yourself. I mean, just listen to any TV theme. I can hear which player played on it. I can tell what Simon Gardner sounds like.
Yeah.
I can tell what Andy Greenwood sounds like. I can tell what Mike Lovett sounds like.
Yeah.
I can hear whether it's Derek Healy on certain things. I can hear whether it's Derek Watkins on certain things. Maybe not everybody hears that, but this is our business. And, we're listening intently to it. And you everybody sounds different. And the idea is to sound like yourself, but be able to emulate people. Mm-hmm. If you need to in a situation. I mean, the business has totally changed over a long period of time, probably of over the last, since the 80s, probably, I'm guessing 90s, in that there always used to be so much work around, in especially the 50s, 60s, and then people were booked to sound like people were booked because they played like them. Tony Fisher, absolute hero of mine. Yeah. And Tony,
I want to get him on this as well. Amazing. Yeah.
Well, Tony, I talked about Mike Thomas and all these other people that have helped me through the years, but Tony has been one of the best people for me. I love him to bits. Tony got me into TV work and into Strictly and all this stuff. But when I first moved down to London, I wasn't doing anything. He got me in the Bert Kaempfert Orchestra that he was running and stuff. But Tony was always booked because Tony played that way, a perfect way, and this and that and the other.
Yeah.
And then there'd be Alan Downey or Derek Healy or Derek Watkins and then Kenny Baker.
Yeah.
And they were always booked because they played this way and people wanted that sound. Whereas modern day trumpet playing, I think, is you have to be a lot more versatile than those guys had to be, because there isn't as much work around.
No.
And, they could afford to just play how they played. Mm. And they were working 5 sessions a day.
Yeah.
Every day of the year,
Yeah.
But now you have to be, you can't be as unique, I don't think, as those guys were. Mm-hmm. Because you've got to play lots of different more styles to be working all the time.
Of course.
And there isn't just that many TV themes or big bands or things to play on way anymore, So you've got to be a lot more versatile and not bland, that's the wrong word, but you've got to rein it in a little bit.
Yeah.
If you get a big band thing where you're playing Sinatra, then you make try your best to sound like Conrad Gozo.
Yeah, of course.
But then it's when and where you can open up, if you know what I mean.
Yeah. Do it tastefully.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. That's great. Just with that as well, for our guys out there that are trying to, hopefully we got some listeners out there that are young. I know we did when Frosty's stream, and they might be sat there going, oh, You know, what is the pathway to be able to get into these studios or these West End shows and stuff like that? So have you got any advice for these guys or people out there who are wanting to have this kind of life, you know, wanting to express themselves musically in the West End, doing sessions and stuff? Is there any, I mean, as you said, jobs are getting fewer and far between. So is there any, I mean, you know, obviously we don't know what the world's going to look like when we come back, but any advice you can give them would be helpful if you've got any.
Absolutely. I mean, things have changed from when I tried to get in the business. 1999, I moved to London, and I was working quite a lot in Manchester of that. But and it was all word of mouth.
Yeah,
you know, you turn up, you do the job, you do it to your best of your ability. Mm-hmm. Sit there, shut up, and you know, and be personable. You know, you can't. Nobody wants a miserable idiots out there all the time, but it was all word of mouth for me. I moved down, and yes, I knew a couple of people, but Andy Wood and Martin Williams got me to move down. They dragged me. Bill Ashton rang me up and said, "I've been told you're moving down. I found you somewhere to live." I was like, "What?" They'd planned it without me knowing, you know. So.
It's good to see you're in control of your life.
Oh yeah. No, Andy and Martin, it was their fault. And Frosty was dragged me down to look at the house I was staying with.
Brilliant.
And then I just went out and did Nigel, find a youth band. Wherever you are, they're all over the country. There's some fantastic bands all over the country, the Midland, the Doncaster, the Wigan, the Aylesbury one. They're all over the place. Go and find one of those bands, and in there you'll get an opportunity to play lots of great music. And always view it as you're trying to hone your craft by absorbing as much as possible.
Yeah.
And while you're out there doing that, people will hear you, and they'll take notice. They won't always tell you, but they'll take notice. You know, and then so that's what I did in London. I was doing Nigel, but I was also going out doing all these blow bands and a Sunday lunch, or I got a function band gig. And they're not easy to come by anymore, but there were loads of function bands. I went with Denny Wise's band for a couple of years. The more and more things you can go out and do at the beginning, people will hear you. And if you conduct yourself properly and play to your best of ability every time, it goes a long way. And like I said, you might not realise, but people are listening. I remember James Morrison saying the first time he got taken to America, he was playing a wedding gig in Australia, and Red Rodney happened to be at the wedding, heard him playing and took him to America. You know, you never know who's there.
Yeah, and that's why you always got to play to the best ability, don't you?
Absolutely. So you just got to get out there and do as much. Listen, buy albums. You know, don't restrict yourself to just doing nothing but listening to Chet Baker, as brilliant as Chet Baker is. Go and buy a Prince album or something, or you know, Tower of Power, Earth, Wind and Fire. Go and buy Stevie Wonder albums. James Taylor.
Yeah.
Wow. Musicianship and all that. It's stunning, you know. And, you know, really pay attention when you're listening to music and of all the different styles, and try and learn from when you're listening, whether you're listening to the production side of it, not let alone the playing. But one of the things I always loved doing was whenever I got introduced to any new music was just listening to the rhythm sections, whether it be Prince with Michael B or on drums or something, or whether it would be Carlos Vega with James Taylor on drums and Lee Sklar or whoever on bass. I just used to, I still love just locking into the rhythm section.
Yeah.
And then just listening to a fantastic rhythm section just lock together and groove gives you this. If you're interested in that, do it, because it sticks in you there. And then I like to think, other people might have different opinions, but I like to think that that's always stuck with me. So my time is always pretty good.
Yeah.
Pretty good.
Relative.
You have to play.
It has to be,
depending on what you're playing, but listen and listen and listen, not just to the instrument that you play.
Yeah.
really listen to the groove and what the rhythm section's doing. And, you know, and the more you listen and the more you just get yourself out there playing.
Yeah.
That was how I went about it. Yes, I had friends that I'd known before who heard me and went, oh, I didn't know you were down. I tell you what, you know, there's always those little ins and stuff.
Of course.
But in this, in I don't want to sound like such an old fart, but in this day and age as well, you know, that you need to get yourself out there online.
Yeah.
You know, but record yourself. There's nothing better than recording yourself and listening back to yourself, because you'll always find the biggest flaws within yourself, hopefully.
Yeah.
So recording yourself and listening back and going, oh, I don't like that, or this, is a great way to learn and teach yourself. But actually put things out there on social media these days. Mm. Well, look at Louis Dowdswell, you know.
Of course.
Prime Louis example. Was, as far as I'm concerned, one of the first to do that. He was recording himself while he was at, what's the school in Watford he was at? Purcell School, yeah. You know, and he put that up there, and next thing you know, Wayne Bergeron's emailing him.
I know, yeah.
You know, I mean, yes, Louis is a monster player, you know.
Yeah.
But you've got to use social media these days. And why not? Because especially in this day and age where there's no gigs to go and listen to or gigs to go and play.
That's it.
As an up-and-coming player these days, you've got to embrace social media in that way. You know,
yeah.
Try not to be a Kim Kardashian of it. But,
yeah, we don't need any more of the Kim Kardashians. Thanks, that'd be great. I think you've just nailed it. Like, literally get yourself out there in any way, shape, form, just, and you'll not only, like you said, record yourself, listen back. You'll not only discover how you want to sound just from that, but you'll also discover how you want to move forward. I think is, and that's, you know, like, you'll always be like, you might not be able to hit that note higher or something like that. But you record yourself and you can watch yourself while you're doing it and go,
Well, there's always the three rules.
What's that?
I don't think I can mention them on here, to be honest. But the three rules of the day that they were never mentioned, but it was all, everybody knew them, was turn up on time.
Yeah.
Play to the best of your ability. And don't be a.
Yeah. Very good. And they are the rules to live by.
So, absolutely.
A few other people have dropped in. Annette Tuck says, enjoy listening to the interview. I'll be messaging your mum shortly.
Oh, really? I'm glad I never swore then.
That's all right. And Steve Lees has come on and says, really looking forward to the Maynard tribute. Was lucky enough to see him live at Ronnie's a number of times. So without further ado, shall we move on to what's happening this weekend? I saw a very confusing post. I don't know why they worded it like that, when they said live tonight. And I went, what? Where's the advertising for this? Yeah, anyway.
It's just the link that they send out. But yes, I was asked a few weeks ago to do a live stream with my big band from Ronnie's. And Ronnie's idea was to do a Maynard tribute. Because years ago, just after Maynard died, I did a tribute with Pete Long's band there. Amazing. And I did all the Maynard things. And it was when I was a lot younger and stupider, and played all the Maynard things. So they asked me to do that, but it tied in with a conversation I had with Bobby Shue again.
Yeah.
Mr. Shue.
Yeah.
And he emailed me a few months ago in the first lockdown saying that he was just bored at home and he has his big office and he has so many albums and scores and everything. It's ridiculous if you've ever seen it. And he'd found 300 and scores that were written by Alan Downey. Alan was one of the great British trumpet players in the 70s and 80s and all that lot. He played with everybody in the UK and all the guest artists that came over. But him and Bobby became very good mates when Bobby came over with the Louis Belson band, and Alan did the tour with them there in the 70s, I want to say. I'm not sure.
Yeah.
Well, obviously, Alan wrote Maynard's tune, Give It One.
Yeah, very famous.
So Alan, Alan's writing was brilliant. He also wrote We've Only Just Begun for Derek Watkins, which is a may. Well, he never wrote that, obviously. He arranged it.
Yeah.
His writing and arranging was phenomenal. Alan had not been well for a while, and Bobby Shue, because they were mates, rang him up, said, I know you're not being well, but I'll tell you what, I'll give you something to do. Write me some charts. I want some new features. You know, they don't have to be silly, but... And Alan went, yeah, okay. And the next thing Bobby knew about it, he had a call, I think, from Paul Davis, telling him that Alan had died in 2005. And then literally the next morning, Bobby got through his mail these three scores that Alan had written.
Wow.
So he'd written them within a couple of weeks of dying. Now, Alan didn't I don't know if Alan knew he was on the way out or not, but he did these charts. And Bobby, you know, put them away and meant to come back to them. And he found them again. So Bobby very kindly got in touch and said, listen, because Alan was from the UK, he's from Liverpool, and did all that, they should be played in the UK. So he sent me the scores. So Richard Sidwell has very kindly copied them all out for me. And we've sent them to Bobby, of course, but they're going to be played for the very first time.
That's
incredible. Ronnie's. So I got Ronnie's to agree to, because of the link with Alan and Maynard anyway, we're going to split it up between, we're going to start with Give It One, which is a Maynard thing that Alan wrote.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's going to be one of the new ones. And then Andy Greenwood's going to play, I think, Country Road off the Emma Thorne album. Cy Gardner's going to play one of the new Alan Downey charts. And then Sammy Main's going to play a beautiful alto feature of My Foolish Heart, which Alan Downey arranged several years ago for the BBC band. And then Ryan Quigley's going to play a waltz for Bill Evans, which is another one of the brand new Downey charts.
Wow.
And then we're going to pick a few more Maynard things in to finish it up. So.
Yeah, of course. I mean, this is going to be an incredible gig, and I think it's super exciting because obviously, you know, gigs haven't been able to be happened
for
ages. And the fact that you guys can get together and do this is just amazing. So where can they find this link? It's on Ronnie Scotts, is it?
It's on the Ronnie Scotts website. I've got my Facebook page.
Yeah.
Just Craig Wilde, you'll find me.
What I'll do as well, I'll put the link in the description for this video.
Right. Or literally, it's the Ronnie Scotts Facebook page or the Ronnie Scotts website. I'm pretty sure they've got a YouTube page as well.
Yeah, I think they do, yeah.
It's Sunday night, this Sunday coming, 7th of February. We'll go live at 8 o'clock.
Mm-hmm.
It's just one set, 8 till 9:15. And we're just going to all see if we can play the instruments again after nearly a year of not.
Well, you've picked a hell of a gig to bring them back with, I'll tell you.
No, well, I think it's fine. It will be fine. We all know what we're doing. And
of course.
To be honest, it's given a lot of people, me included, something to practice for again, you know.
Of course, yeah.
In this day and age, it's terrible, you know. The gig is free to watch.
Mm-hmm.
But there is a donation link because none of the band are going to get paid. We'll only get paid through whatever donations come through. So I understand musicians especially have had it, we've all had it hard for almost a year now. But if you're enjoying what you're seeing on Sunday, that, you know, buy us a pint or something. You know,
yes.
A fiver won't buy you a pint at Ronnie Scott.
No.
But it's free to watch, but any donations will. It not only do the band receive the donations, the club takes some money as well because the club needs to stay open and running.
Yeah.
And it's such a historical, amazing jazz club that gives opportunities to players from all around the world all the time. So it's a good thing to support, I think.
Massively, yeah. I can't recommend this gig highly enough. Honestly, anyone listening, because I know we've got guys listening, if you're watching this back, tell your friends, tell your family, spread the word. And honestly, if you can, even if it's £10, £20, you know, like £5, well, whatever, a couple of pennies, you know, like
whatever, people.
Yeah, exactly.
I understand it's a difficult time for everybody, but it's free to watch. But if you do feel as though you can donate, that would be more than appreciated.
Steve Lees, thank you very much. Steve Lees has come in and he's actually put the link right there. So I'll make sure that is down. If you need to make a copy of that, please do. Paul Mason's dropped by and he said, I'll buy you both a pint anytime. Cheers,
hey,
Paulie. Now, you used to have some stories, but we won't go into that in this stream.
He's got too far up in the army now. I can't really tell.
That's true. Yeah.
Well, he's a warrant officer or something now.
Yeah, that's right. He is. Yeah.
Well, I met Paul in the Wigan band years ago, but we also cruised around the Caribbean together for several months.
You both had hair then, didn't you?
96, 97 it was. Yeah, we both had hair. I was skinny. Yeah. I was skinny and had hair, you know.
I discovered it. There was a photo when I Googled your name. That was a photo that came up. And you had long locks, man, all the way to your shoulders. It was impressive.
Oh, my team. I was a rocker. Yeah. Yeah. I still got my guitar t-shirt on now.
Hey, there it is.
I had the earrings, the hair, skinny, everything.
Oh, it's brilliant. Craig, I can't thank you enough, mate, for joining me today and chatting about your life.
That's a pleasure. Thank you.
I wish you all the best with the gig. As a musical director, it's been a pleasure to watch you. I remember watching you when you launched. You directed the band during Louis' album launch, and that was incredible. You rehearsed the band for that. That was amazing as well. I just can't wait for this gig. It's going to be great. Good luck with it. Good luck with everything. And hopefully in 6 months' time, we may get together again and have a chat and things will be different.
That would be nice, wouldn't it? It'd be nice to be able to see everybody in person.
It certainly would.
Yeah. Fingers crossed with it all. But thanks very much for having me on. I really appreciate it.
More than welcome, guys. Don't forget about the gig this Sunday at 7 o'clock. Is that right? That's correct, isn't it?
8 p.m. start.
8 p.m. start. There you go. Yeah, so get there.
Probably log online a little bit earlier, but we're going to start at 8 p.m.
So. There you go. Or maybe. So get there a quarter to eight with a pint in your hand, ready to go, ready to log on.
Oh, yeah.
It's
a loud, blary trumpet night.
Exactly. So
get your drinks ready and sit down and, you know, turn the computer on.
Or put it on the big screen. You can do that these days. So do that.
Well, you can do that.
Exactly. Anyway, guys. And thanks so much, everyone, for tuning in. Thank you so much for Craig for giving us the time and the experience and the inspiration to keep going in these times. And yeah, Craig, can't wish you or any more than just the best. And I can't wait to buy you a pint very soon.
Thank you very much.
To everyone else there, you stay safe. You stay safe in the practice room, everyone. See you later, Craig. See everyone. I love your work.
Thank you.